Welcome to the Solar Energy Channel, where you'll get an honest insider's look at all things solar. I'm here with Dale, and we're going to give you an update of what we know of the IRA bill as of today, and we're in late October 2023, so keep in mind that things change. You might be watching this video in the future, and a lot of the information might be outdated. So we're recording this late October 2023, and we're going to go through each of the components of the IRA bill and let you know what we know as of now. So welcome, Dale.
Good to be here.
Let's talk first maybe about the domestic content piece and give a summary of what we know about that.
Not very much.
Yeah.
It's incredibly complex.
Yeah.
And I think what we are seeing, Warren, is we're seeing a lot of manufacturing being opened in the U.S.
Yeah.
It's going to take some time. We were contacted just this week by a module manufacturer who said by second quarter of 2024, they expect to have U.S.-made modules.
Okay.
Will they? I don't know. But the domestic content, it's clear as it was written, but it's not practical.
Sure.
You know, I've been in other webinars where they've said that, you know, it's going to have to be rewritten or reinterpreted because it's not practical the way it is. And it's fine as long as everything's U.S. made. But if you have any type of manufactured product that has components that are not U.S. made, it gets really complex for manufacturers. I don't think the manufacturers are going to reveal the information you would need to calculate it.
Yeah. So I think it would be safe to say that for the next 6 to 8 months, there's probably not going to be a lot of manufacturers that are going to comply with the regulations or have the ability to comply.
It's been really, really quiet.
Yeah.
You know, when we talked to our distributors and said, you know, what are the manufacturers saying? We're not hearing anything.
Yeah.
The manufacturers are just like quiet. What we hear is we're building facilities in the U.S.
Right.
And that takes time.
But we still don't even know if those facilities are going to be using components that meet their requirements.
No, because, I mean, even a module, you've got probably 7 components in a module.
Yeah.
The way they look at it. And if they're not all U.S. made, I don't think the manufacturers are going to tell us and certify what they need to do.
Yeah. So at this point, there's really no update on the domestic content because
right.
It's really not available for anybody to use at this point.
I mean, it's going to be there. It's certainly an adder that will eventually get legs.
Yep.
But I just think, you know, in the immediate future, when I'm talking months, we're just not going to see it.
Sure. But then one of the nice things about the domestic content is once we get past the qualification, that you meet the qualification, it's pretty simple to know that you get it. If it's 100% U.S. made, there's no application process to go through or limitations or caps. If you get it, you get it.
Yes. I mean, there'd have to be certifications.
Yes.
You're going to it's not enough to say, well, I bought it from somebody and they said it was U.S. made. There's going to have to be certifications that you send along with your tax return.
Sure. Yeah. Sure. All right. So let's talk about then the energy communities.
This is the easy one.
All right. 10% adder. Yep.
This one's real. And I think this is the one that would affect most of our clients at Paradise. The Department of Energy has a map. For this one and for low income, but they have a map, and if you're within a census tract that is qualifying due to a coal-fired energy plant closure,
yep,
or a coal mine closure, either one of those, or an adjoining census tract, you're going to qualify for this one. The one that's maybe a little less certain is the brownfield sites, which
right.
You and I just talked about, that they're not on the map. So you'd have to know that it's a qualified brownfield if you're going to qualify that. And the MSAs are on the map. Metropolitan statistical areas, which is based on the amount of revenue or the amount of tax revenue that a census tract takes in, and then it has to census tract has to have an unemployment rate that's higher than national average, and that could change every year.
And that's impacted by fossil fuels. Fossil fuel production was removed from that area, then it had an impact on that census tract. They would qualify.
Yeah, but their current unemployment rate would still have to be higher than national average.
Correct.
So if they have a low unemployment rate because some other industry moved in, they wouldn't qualify.
Right, right. And we'll include a link to the map in the description below. So you can go ahead and take a look at that and see if you qualify for that. But keep in mind that the census tract changes every year that you talked about.
Yep.
And how does that impact, Dale, the start of construction or the start of the project, if that changes from the time you sign until the time you get it installed?
Yeah, you can safe harbor that. Basically, the project started is what you have to say. And the safe harbor is part of that. And so if you can prove that, you're good. If the census tract changes after that point, you're okay. It doesn't go when the project's completed. It goes by when the project starts.
Okay.
So as long as you start and you have continuous work on it, you're going to qualify, provided you qualified at that at the start.
All right. Now let's talk about low incomes. This one's a little more challenging.
Yeah. And this is one that does not apply to most of our clients. We're working a lot of times with system owners, but the low income is split into multiple pieces.
Yeah.
It's, you know, Native American tracts and so forth. There's about 1.8 gigawatt cap.
Yeah.
And 700 megawatts are allocated basically to the category that we talk about, which is behind the meter.
Yeah.
And half of that is allocated to nonprofits.
Right.
So the ones that I would see most effectively using this would probably be nonprofits in low-income areas.
Right.
That would be a potential. But to qualify, you have to submit an application to the Department of Energy. That opened on October 19th. It's open for 30 days. Basically, for 30 days, they're taking all the applications they can. They expect to be flooded. And if that happens, there will be a lottery. And then you would be you'd be basically approved as far as applying to the IRS, and then the IRS has to approve it. So it's a dual approval process, Department of Energy, IRS, and then that will be repeated each year.
Right.
So once we get going, once the initial wave is over, there will be a rolling approval process up to that 1.8 gigawatt per year.
Yeah, but for the most part, this doesn't apply to the majority of our customers.
No, I think we're going to see this, Warren, around probably community solar, low-income housing projects that may want to go solar, that sort of thing. And that wouldn't be, you know, it's not a residence in a low-income area. It would have to be a multi-unit residence,
sure.
You know, an investor owns it or something,
yep.
And they're going to apply for, you know, these 500 units are going to, we're going to put solar there.
Super. All right, now let's talk about direct pay.
Yeah, it's a really nice feature. Direct pay allows nonprofits primarily to capitalize on the ITC. And before, nonprofits couldn't. They always had to have third-party owners and go that route. Direct pay gives them the ability to receive that money back from the government. Now, the tricky part about that is timing. You have to register your system, and then you have to file Form 990, which is typically filed in May, like halfway through May of the following, if you're on a calendar year, it's filed. And then you're going to wait possibly a year for the IRS to refund you the money. So if you build your system early in the year, you're going to wait until the following May, and then you may wait another year. So there's going to be this window where you're going to need to finance in some way that 30% tax credit, or it could be 40%, or the adders apply to this.
Sure.
So if you can get the adders, it's a windfall for nonprofits. They just have to be prepared to handle that. You know, the installer is not going to want to wait 2 years to receive payment.
Yeah. Yes, we actually recently did, and we'll link to this in the description below as well, a webinar with Collective Sun, who have two financing options to structure this to cover the direct pay piece of it as well.
They do.
Yep.
And Collective Sun's had some great webinars too. I mean, they've done an outstanding job in my mind of explaining some of these features of the IRA.
Yeah, they really have. All right. And then finally, the last piece is the transferability, or the ability to sell the tax credits.
Yeah. Yeah. So we were just actually, before we started recording this, we're talking about whether residential ones can be transferred. As far as I know, they cannot.
Okay.
I understand it's under the 48C, which is the commercial side of this. And the key with transferability is, how does it work?
Right.
So a system would have to be registered. We know some of the principles, some of the concepts, but we don't have a process for registering the system yet. So you'd register the system, you get a number, registration number, that would follow the tax credits to whoever buys the tax credits. Based on our conversations with other organizations that are looking at ways to create brokerage firms or something for this, it's going to start out only with very large systems.
Okay.
I think it's going to be difficult to connect the buyers and the sellers for any smaller systems due to the admin costs involved, the administration costs involved with creating this transaction. It could be an expensive transaction.
Sure. And the marketplace, not only does the marketplace not exist now, but there's still risk on the person who takes the tax credit once they sell it, correct?
Yeah, I mean, the recapture risk goes with the buyer.
Right.
So if some system owner does something that creates a recapture situation for the person who bought the tax credit, they're liable. And there's a thought out there that there'll be an insurance platform that comes up around that to insure buyers against that. I don't know what that's going to look like. But there is a recapture risk to the buyer of a tax credit. So, yeah, and tax credits can be sold in slices. You could, if you have a really large tax credit, you could sell it to three buyers, for instance.
Yeah.
But then recapture risk would go with all three of them.
Correct. You can't break it up, though, and sell the adders. You have to sell the whole tax credit can be broken up in its entirety.
Yeah, you have to think about it kind of like a pie.
Right.
The whole ITC is the pie, and that includes any adders that go to, and you can sell a slice of that pie.
Right. And also, you can't sell it to family members or
any
common ownership businesses. You can't do those.
Can't be a related party.
Right. Correct. Here at the Solar Energy Channel, we have hundreds of videos that do a deep dive into solar incentives, solar module comparisons, inverter comparisons, and really everything solar. So take a look at the videos to take a deep dive and get started.